Hi again then, guys, and welcome to my very first review from the first Project Gotham title. We've reviewed cars from Project Gotham 3 and 4, and will continue to do so, but we've never done any for the second game yet, and this is the very first one for the first Project Gotham game, and chances are it will probably be a 4:3 aspect ratio, not the full 16:9, so you will probably see some black bars at the side of the screen. Personally, I hate that kind of visual, but of course it is an original Xbox title, which is why it's shown that way, in a very similar way to the vast majority of PS2 games. Now, this particular vehicle is a very significant place to start for me, because we're only actually going to review like 6 or 7 cars from this first game. And the reason for that is because, as some of you who have checked out my reviews before will know, I only review the cars from older games that no longer appear in the franchise. So if there's a car that appears in Project Gotham 1 and then Project Gotham 4, then I will only review it in the fourth game, because that's the newest interpretation of the car in the franchise. So all of these cars that I review are no longer featured in any of the other games, which is pretty crazy in some cases, one in particular that we'll get to in this series. Now, the reason why I'm starting with this one is because, and many of you may not know this, this is actually my favorite sports car in the world. And it's one of the only racing games to actually feature it. Now, a couple of games do feature the Panos Esperante, even Forza does, for instance, but it's a different version. The version which I'm not as much of a fan of, even though it's faster, which is called the GTLM, which is a quicker car, it's more powerful, you've got like 420 horsepower. However, this one is my favorite. It has the pure, clean, very simple visual design, and although you will sometimes hear people compare this version in particular of the Panos Esperante as kind of like the American equivalent of a Porsche 911, which to some degree is true, I would actually say it's far more accurate to compare this to America's answer to TVR, in particular the TVR Tuscan and the TVR Chimera especially. They are very, very similar. Similar size engine, similar power, similar performance, and even a very similar appearance. Now, the appearance of this car in the game, of course, not surprisingly at all of a game of its age and graphics, is not exactly authentic to real life. It's good for its age, but the car is flatter and wider than it actually is in real life, which, of course, doesn't look bad. If anything, it makes it look more like a TVR, but in real life, it's a little bit narrower than it's shown in the game, especially from the back. Now, in terms of unlocking this car and getting it in the game, I actually haven't played through Project Gotham 1. So the way that I got the car is actually very simple. Now, you can get this one of two ways. To unlock this vehicle in the traditional, legitimate way, you need to earn 25,000 kudos. Fairly simple. It's one of the easier vehicles to get, in fact, compared to something like 150, 200,000 for a Carrera GT or Ferrari F50. However, you can actually get it right from the start of the game if you input your driver name as NOSLIW, with a capital N at the start. If you do that, you get all of the cars, all of the tracks, everything right from the start of the game. Now, usually I wouldn't do that, I would play through the game, but of course with these reviews, it's nice to have a head start so that I can access all of the cars. So there's a tip if you want to try that out, and it's kind of a shame that games don't really feature cheat codes anymore. It was a cool little thing. Now, as far as this car goes in terms of spec, you've got handling, acceleration, and top speed rated in the game. So how does it stack up? Well, of course, it's not a top-tier machine, but with that being said, it's actually pretty well rated. It's got a handling rating of 6, an acceleration rating of 7, and a top speed rating also of 7. Now, there are very few, if any, places in this game that you can actually get over 170 to 180 miles per hour, so it's not like top speed matters as much as it would in, for instance, Project Gotham 3 or 4, where you can take stuff like an Ultima Aero or a Y2K turbine superbike around New York at well over 230. So it's not exactly the same kind of playing field. However, it is interesting to note how the cars do still compare. Now, this Panos, as much as I love it, is not the greatest thing around corners, I will say that. But the funny thing is, it's not necessarily not as good as you'd expect in the way that you would expect. And what I mean by that is, you would probably assume that a front-engine, rear-wheel drive, Ford SVT-powered sports car, which is what this is, a 4.6-litre, 320 horsepower V8, around 160, 170 miles per hour flat out, 0 to 60 in under 5 seconds, so healthy across the board, especially for its age. But you'd probably assume that just like a TVR or a Cobra or even a Porsche 911, that it would be very tail happy, very slippery. And although in this video you can see me for sure getting the tail out on the car, that's ironically not the issue. Now, you only notice this on certain tracks in particular. I would say that New York is a prime example, where I first tried to drive this car, in fact the first time I'd ever played the game, around New York, a very long circuit. Very tight roads, all 90 degree corners. That's nothing new for Project Gotham, most of the tracks are like that, but it felt awful. The brakes were extremely weak, the handling felt really heavy, and sometimes it would turn in too sharply, sometimes it was way too understeery and would just crash into the outside wall. Now again, a game of its age of course is not going to stack up to even Project Gotham 3 or 4's physics, as arcadey as they still are, but the fact remains, it's not a great handling car if the track is really tight. However, on this track, where I'm taking it here in the video, it feels way better. So the key to using this Panos in the game is to use it on a track which has nice and spacious roads. It doesn't matter how tight the corners are, as long as the roads are wide. You can still have a 90 degree turn, but as long as you've got a good amount of runoff for the car, it feels great. So much better, in fact, on this track than on New York. And even the brakes feel better here for some strange reason. Now, the funny thing about this car is, and this goes for a lot of the cars that I love, a lot of people don't really understand why I love it so much. It certainly has very polarizing looks. The style is not for everyone, that's for sure. And even more so, I would say, the GTLM. But that's kind of why I love it. It's an underdog, it's a sports car that isn't really talked about that much, kind of like Noble in the UK with their older models, or Ascari. But I love it for that. It's different, it's oddball, but it's not just oddball and different for the sake of it. It's actually a very impressive sports car against stuff like TVRs, Corvettes, and the, for instance, 996 shape Porsche 911. So overall, if you do get the chance to try it out in the game, don't expect it to be the best thing out there, because it definitely isn't. But it's very cool to be able to experience Panos at all, because there aren't that many games that do feature them, but also this model specifically, it's one of the only places where you can get your hands on this car and actually drive it. And for me, as a huge super fan of the vehicle, that is a big deal, kind of like the Y2K Superbike in Project Gotham 4. Again, pretty much the only place that you can access that vehicle. But overall, that's it for my thoughts. Of course, I look forward to revisiting this first game, and also the second game as well in due time. But for now, as always, thanks for watching.